Welcome to Sailing Vessel Seeker. My name is Doug, and I am in a very warm and toasty aft cabin.
And that's because I just got through installing another forced air diesel heater, and it is pumping it down from up above.
And it's one of these cheap 150 buck Chinese jobs.
Because the reviews got pretty good, and for 150 bucks, you can buy a lot of them compared to buying the expensive models.
So we'll walk you through the install and show you the things not to do, because I learned there are a couple of them.
Well, I've rummaged under my floors, and I think I've got the aluminum stock I need. I also came across a tile I hadn't seen in a while, and this is one I like.
Do just once what others say you can't do, and you will never pay attention to their limitations again.
Captain James Cook.
He certainly succeeded.
All right, so a bracket for the heater and also for a fan. So there's the Chinese diesel heater, and you're supposed to install it so it goes through the floor or the sidewall of the vehicle, and we're not going to do that. We didn't do it on one that's down there. And it's been working fine, so we're going to build another one that sits off the wall, actually. So what we do is we run the exhaust back outside, but the fresh air, we let it draw from the inside, as well as the fuel line stays on the inside.
They didn't exactly build these things to go in boats, but we know the modifications for it. And get rid of this piece of crap. 10, this just becomes a template for us. We're going to make this bracket out of aluminum.
I'm going to use one of these fancy Greenlee hole cutters here, but the pilot bit for these things is sort of fragile and expensive.
And it's one of those custom bits you can't sharpen. I don't like those kind of bits. So I use a standard drill for drilling the pilot hole.
And that bit just lives inside the kit.
Now, if we were going to drill sheet metal all day long, I don't think it'd matter, but I send this thing through steel. And it's done a good job, even on quarter inch stainless. Today, we just got some quarter inch aluminum. And on the thick stuff, you can pop this spring out of there. You want to push against it all day long.
Yeah, I should have put some oil on there. Got a tooth gummed up.
Well, it wasn't welded in there. It was just kind of gummed up in there.
I mentioned in a previous video that I'm too lazy to go get the oil, and somebody mentioned soap, bar soap, but liquid soap ought to work too.
It'll be easy to wash off and
won't need to use acetone to get it off like you would with oil, because oil will jack up the welds.
Breeze is kind of chilly out there. This almost feels like appropriate work to be doing. There we go. Let's see. Now, I either have to be able to get those bolts off there along with the fuel line and the vents, or I gotta make it unbolt out here, which I think is what I'm gonna do.
Now, I could tap those.
Yeah, that'd be nice. I wouldn't have to mess with a nut on the back side.
Yeah, the soap's working good here too. Oh, we're making an exhaust for it. Oh yeah. And I got a lathe downstairs, but you know, some things they're just faster to do it by hand. Besides that, you need that skill too, because you never know, you may not always have a lathe around. In fact, most of you probably don't. Okay, so what I'm thinking is this 3/4 and this 1 inch. Now we'll make a nice, you know, removable bracket. A little high temperature sealant in there, and we'll take care of the rest of the fit. Welcome to underneath the kitchen countertop. So I got 2 1-inch pieces of foam in here. That's 2 inches thick, and some construction tape over the top of that. This is glue, this yellow stuff. That's coal tar on the steel hull outside. I only need to make it about 2 inches wider so it'll fit my bracket. I measured from this bulkhead to here. So I'll take my 2 inches out over here. Let's go more than 2 inches so we don't have to do it but once. And our heater then goes up there, and we're gonna drill through the brackets a little bit to mark the holes.
You know, on second thought, it'll be easier to take the heater off the bracket and then mount the bracket without the heater. But we now know it all fits.
All right, the 4 holes are drilled. Now I'm gonna tap them. And I'm not gonna thread from this side. The taps are to hold the bolts in place. They'll come from the other side. That's beautiful. These winter days make for short work days, though.
Try not to fall into the drink and put a little never seize on the bolt and get the bolt to go into, yes, the hole. Okay. And the next job is to run the exhaust through the hole, too. Well, I happen to have a broom handle, and we can put that through the exhaust pipe there. And where it touches the hole is where we need to cut the hole.
So with that pipe stuck in there, I marked where this flange gets welded on.
There it goes. Okay, that's how it's going to go on. So that's the top. Now we got to make a box out here or something to keep the ocean from coming inside.
Let's cut this one right there.
I think we are done. I'm leaving a little opening on this side where the exhaust goes in because I want the water to drain out there. What water does make it back around.
And that was enjoyable. I got some practice on TIG.
Okay, that is on. The duct work is next, but I gotta go to town.
Well, there's a PPG paint store just 4.5 miles away, and somewhere in that pile is a fuel line for our heater. Because you don't want to use the one the Chinese give you. It's about as sturdy as a soda straw, so we'll have a good fuel line. And enough of it too, I need almost 20 feet, which is about the maximum length.
Not a bad sunrise.
So this is the fuel line. All it is 4 millimeter hose. It's a really strong stuff. I'm just putting a short piece on here because I'll put another coupler where I can actually reach it when this thing's mounted. This will stay permanently connected here for, you know, taking it off the wall and such, because I'll do it from the bolt holes here. And then all it is a piece of rubber hose that comes with the kit and some clamps, and it holds it together lovely.
Welcome back under the cabinet. We are cutting through quarter inch steel plate with a carbide hole cutter. It's doing a fantastic job. Slow, but it works. So that's the insulation foam down below. Got to cut another hole right here for the fan, the ventilation fan. So heater, fan.
Favorite bird is out there. He's underwater right now. This is the weirdest bird in the world. They call it a snake bird. Oh, there he is. He came up. And he went back down. The seagull's hanging around because he's going to steal. Oh, hey. The seagull's going to try and steal. Oh, oh, look at that. Did he get it? Yeah, he looks a little pissed, but I didn't see he get anything. But that's what he's trying to do is steal it.
Now, his real name's not Snake Bird, of course, but that one works really well. What he does with that really sharp beak is he goes down underwater, he finds a fish, and he stabs it with his beak. And he comes up to the surface, waits for it to die, flips it off, and catches it. So that's why the seagull is hanging out there, too. He's trying to steal it.
Oh, he's got one! He's got one! Look at there! He got one! And the seagull's trying to steal it. Look at that! Oh, he took it, you little bastard!
Now a bunch more seagulls show up, so this guy's hunting days are over.
Now he went back down to try it again. Nope, nothing this time. But that's the truth about seagulls. They're just lazy assholes on welfare.
That's it. Go hunt somewhere else. On the last one, I didn't use any soap, but I found if I run the bit a lot faster, which is dangerous because when it binds up, it can almost like break your arm. But at a high speed, it throws the shavings out to the side so they don't get gummed up in the teeth. There we go.
little sealant goes in because I don't want any water going down below. See that right there? That's a drain outside the bottom of the boat. The whole pilot house has the ability to drain. There's one of these drains in each corner. I made these mounts really sturdy because I store kitchen appliances down in here and I don't want to bumping into them and breaking them. So the blower fan for cooling is mounted on this riser, and the other one, it takes the duct from the heater. So don't run them at the same time, but each is the return for the other. And a little more of this lovely sealant to join the two ducts together.
It's Christmas parade night on Boca Ciega Bay. We get to see a lot of Santa Clauses and Christmas lights go by tonight. I tell you what, this is my kind of Christmas too. It hit 80 degrees today, I think.
Everybody else is local too?
Yeah,
local. Oh, well, well done. Thank you for sharing your bay with me.
Oh, yeah.
See you later.
All right, enjoy your evening.
And a beautiful sunset to go along with it all.
Don't you just love those electrical boxes that are all just beautifully done? This is not that. But I got to do some work in here today to run some power for the heater and the fan. So I'm going to install a bus bar so I don't have to have all these loops of wire running through here. And then I'm going to put 24 volt in it too, because that fan is 24 volt. That fan will run mainly when the engine is running and it's 24 volt on its alternator. So don't have to run it through a DC to DC converter. So these are both 12 volt wires coming off the main supply downstairs. I run two. I'm sure that's not code, but that's a great way of getting twice the amperage up without getting hot wires, because you know I just don't know what I'm going to plug into here. And then the bus bar just snaps into there and replaces all those little jumpers, and I'll tighten down all these lugs. I got one extra lug down here on the bottom, because if I can't get these hots jammed in there, then I'll figure out a way of attaching them there, like a crimp-on fitting. Also, not code. Turns out they fit in there just fine, and I added two more breakers at the top just for expansion, and I got a hot lug hanging off the bottom. I'll cover that up with some electric tape. Power cord goes in, which is called an old extension cord that was thrown out, and we'll run 24 volt on one and 12 volt on the other. Sure, that's not code. The diesel line will join that as well, and it's a good opportunity to clean everything out of the cabinets, and we'll run it back to the back. Now, we already have the tank installed because we did it when we did this first heater. Yeah, here comes the rain again. He's going to be wet, but he's going to make it. He's going right to there. And I'm getting a good opportunity to clean stuff because I run the fuel and power line along. Got the anti-ox out, and then my lovely wire nuts. And the problem with wire nuts, people, is you got to give them a pull. If you can pull the wire out, you did it wrong. You're just not twisting it on hard enough. So everybody gives that, well, I tell you what, the little weakling kids we got nowadays give these things a bad name. But it ain't the wire nuts' fault. You need to have a little more strength in your hands. And then some liquid tape. Mine's turned to goo, but still working. And fill up that wire nut. It is sealed off and protected even if it does leak. Good stuff, Maynard. Let them hang down and let that ooze down into them. Let them dry up like that. And it's just one way of doing it. There's lots of ways of doing it out there. I got my heat shrink crimp connectors with me too, but this is some 10 gauge wire that I'm running down into the cabin, so connecting 10 gauge to 14 gauge is kind of a pain to do, so I just decided to use the old wire nut trick. Let's see, turn the 24 volt on. I hear the fan running. He needs to switch it on. All right, sit down, see what it's doing.
Oh yeah, that is a lot of air. I can feel it from here.
Going down through that hole right up in there. It just comes down the wall, makes a nice draft across the room.
And yes, powered through an AC switch. Not sure how long that's going to last, but I'm willing to find out. 24 volts, probably about 4 amps on that motor. And the idea is not to run it constantly. When we came over here, we had the engine on for, you know, nearly 2 days straight. So this room gets hot in summertime. So that just, you flip it on, it ventilates the air out, and you turn it back off. It also gets stale back in here, so that'll help dry this cabin out and keep it fresh. And with the engine running, you wouldn't even recognize that noise. But I do like things loud enough that you know they're on.
I got both heaters run to the same breaker, so we'll flip them on. Yep, this one's come on. Yeah, this one's on too, that's great. Now it's gonna take a long time to prime the fuel up here, so what I'm gonna do is detach the fuel line from the pump and let it flow through. And then I'm gonna extend this cable so I can put this little control unit downstairs. There's 3 conductors on the controller for this heater. I'm using these heat up solder type connectors. I put a little flux on the wire before I start on them, and that seems to help a lot. You're just gonna take it easy on them with a torch air gun. It's probably the better way to go if you're new at it and don't want to burn through, but just be patient. There, I can see it flowing out. And let it cool down before you pull on it. So see, I got fuel in that line over there. That's because I took it off and then sucked it up to this point, reattached it to the pump, and that'll save a lot of time. Because now we've got to cycle that pump multiple times to get the diesel on over to the heater.
So we hold the arrow up and arrow down button together. And it will start pumping fuel.
I haven't even heard the pump come on yet.
Let me start it up again. And show you, we got a problem here. And that little symbol is the pump, so it's running the pump.
No battery voltage. Please increase the power supply voltage.
That's it. Now, I think the problem is that 14-gauge wire I ran from the breaker on back. And that, and I don't get my 12 volts off a car battery or a truck battery, so it literally is just 12 volts. So your car battery will always be around 12.9, 12.8, sometimes 13. But I'm using a DC to DC converter to come down from 24 volts off my other batteries, which actually run about 26, 27 volts. So I'm actually giving it 12 volts from those DC to DC converters that are back in behind there. And that runs up and down into the other breaker panel and then winds its way back here. And if I just turn it on, it'll actually give me the voltage readout here, 9 volts. Anything lower than, I think, 10 is its low voltage cutout, so it's going to be upset about that.
No battery voltage.
Yep.
Increase the power supply voltage.
So let's run another cable and see if we can prevent the voltage drop, or lessen it, as I should say.
Okay, there's a new wire to test the theory, which just adds on to the what's already there. That one. No sparks, no smoke, good.
Start.
Start to work.
At 10.5 volts. 10.7.
0.5 is the lowest I've seen. Ah, there it is, I can hear it.
Yay!
10.4, 10.5. Yeah, it's holding its voltage fine now. So it's got the glow plugs running, the fan running, the pump running. That's gonna do it.
So now I just take all the cabinets apart again and run another wire through there. Ah. Oh yeah, lovely warm air. So extending the wire for the control panel, not a problem. But if you're going to be a long way from battery, and in worst case scenario, a long way from a DC to DC converter, which gives you just 12 volts, then you're going to have to run a lot more copper to keep the voltage up at the heater. See, once it gets going, the glow plugs go off. The voltage comes back up. And there's a fan mode on this heater, so if we do just want a little bit of ventilation back here, we can run its fan, which would be a lot less air, but very quiet.
And here it is in the manual. Factory under voltage default, 10.5 volts. Now, while we're here, let me show you this too. This heater can only be mounted within 90 degrees, either, you know, down through the floor or through a wall. With this is the heat end coming out of it, so that's how we have it done there. And in fact, we're a little bit rotated back, and that's good because we're a boat, we roll. So the bulwark there is at about, oh, it's about a 15 degree angle, so this thing is actually between this, so we get to heel and it doesn't go past that 90. I'm not sure if that would matter, but we're safe there.
And yes, these are officially gadgets because you can download an app to run the thing. So if you just want the fan, just put it into a temperature mode and then bring the temperature way down, and it will just be a fan.
I have an uphill run to my fuel pump all the way from the tank, but then I got a little loop that goes over to the heater, and it's doing that all right. It says when conditions allow, make sure it's an uphill run, and they want this pump in at an uphill too, say between 30 and 45. Mine's not nearly that, it's more like maybe 12, and it's working all right too. So there are some leeways that you can get by with. Second cable going in, and here's an idea for you.
If you want to hold cables in place but you can't nail into them, then put the zip tie around it and then glue the head of the zip tie onto the surface you can't nail into.
And that'll keep it from bouncing around.
And when you gotta tear it out, it won't be so bad.
Well, I pulled it out because, oops, I routed the fuel line too close to the exhaust. So do it again, and be sure to run the fuel line underneath the mount. That'll keep it away. And let me put a zip tie there. So yeah, don't do that.
So I went ahead and tidied up the electrical while I was replacing that fuel line. Now I'm just gonna get it to prime again.
Okay,
I found a reason to like this app. I can actually talk to the heater downstairs. It goes through the acrylic viewport. See, turn that on, put it in pump. It should start running it.
Took it a little while, but there it goes. It's priming. I'm gonna take that hose off and try and get that air bubble to move all the way down it.
As that moves along, I can lower it back down. There we go. Now she's getting excited.
All right, it's all primed up and running at high speed. Doing well. Fuel line, electrical's taken care of. I think we're done.
Well, I don't have a lot of time on them, but so far I like these little forced air diesel heaters, and we're probably going to put one in this forward cabin too. I'm thinking right up in the companionway there, or maybe right up above the bathroom. Something to keep the crew quarters warm. But before that happens, we need to put some more water underneath this boat's keels. See if we can break something. You know, it's nice to have something to fix. It's important. And it's nice to learn how to sail. Tell you what, I've been itching to move. It's funny how once you got a little bit of sail time, you want more. We'll see you soon. Oh, what you been doing? Hope you've been out in your shop working on something. If you have, send us a picture of it. Send it to svseeker@ymail.com. What'd you make today?